أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفدا. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي، فنفوز فوزا عظيما. سلام.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How quickly the life of this dunya passes. It was just like as if it was last night that I came for the first talk. Was it on Sunday? Last Sunday, yes, alhamdulillah. And unfortunately this time, although it wasn't in my control, but I had a flu almost all the nights through. Alhamdulillah, you managed to tolerate me and my voice and my terrible look. And I managed to, alhamdulillah, deliver somehow what I had in mind to share with you. Thank you very much for your patience, for your hospitality, brothers, sisters, those who have arranged and seen, mashallah, they are providing. Now I can see tea with, you call it hell in it. Alright, alhamdulillah. Jazakumullah khairan. No, definitely, and I'm not flattering you, definitely this last week that I've spent here was one of the best time of my life, very good experience. I really saw nothing other than extreme hospitality. Barakallahu feekum. Thank you very much. And inshallah, looking forward to see you more often in the future. Anytime you get a chance to come to Iran, I'm based in Isfahan at the moment. Inshallah, you can contact me and you're most welcome to come. Rest assured that you have a place, inshallah, in Isfahan. And we have a lot of space for you. You don't need to worry about the accommodation. You'll be my guest of honor. Even though I had in mind to say something else for tonight, that I'd already advertised for it, and I said that make sure you don't miss it tomorrow night, it's an important, but there was a request more than once, and that's why in the last minute I decided against what I had in mind to talk, and will be sharing with you something different. The topic therefore for tonight, based on the request of some of the brothers and sisters, is about the language of clothing. In a simple word, the topic for tonight is about the wisdom and philosophy of hijab and the Islamic dress code in Islam. Why is it that we have hijab, and this concept of hijab, where is it coming from? Is it an obligation or is it an option? Especially for those living in the West, is there still an obligation? Is it an Arabic or like a Middle Eastern sort of tradition, or is it an Islamic tradition? No matter where you live, we are expected to practice it. In as much as Salat is an Islamic tradition, no matter where you live, and you know, we have to practice it. I have three approaches in a long, cutting a long story short, I have three approaches to the topic. One is a psychological approach, the second, a biblical approach, and the third is an Islamic approach. So we, inshallah, discuss the issue from three different angles. Even, and inshallah will prove it, that even if one does not want to believe in Islam, yet wants to have a decent, modest life, a girl, a woman who wants to have a modest, decent life, they are expected to observe this practice of Islamic dress code of hijab. Even if a female wants to be a committed Jewish person, wants to be a committed Christian, is expected to practice hijab and the Islamic dress code, let alone as Muslim. Let's begin. What is the function of clothing? What is it that we decide to wear and cover our bodies? What do you think? This is an issue that psychologists who discuss the issue of clothing, they delve into it. Long story short, there are two famous theories, two famous opinions on the topic. One is that the function of clothing is seduction. They say, especially talking about the female side, they say they dress so that they seduce, to attract the opposite, like sex. So the purpose and the function of clothing is to be more seductive. And that's why you see they go with all the fashions. And that's why that being naked is not very appealing, but semi-naked is more appealing. Because the wisdom, the psychology behind that is to be seduced, seductive, and to seduce. This is one theory and has its own, supporters. Opposite to that is another theory that they say, no, the purpose of clothing for man is protection. When you look at the primitive man from the very early time, the reason that man used to be naked, so to speak, and then, as Quran says, they covered themselves, Adam and Eve, with the leaves of trees. And later on, clothing came into, and fabrics and things like that came into fashion. What was the purpose of that? To protect themselves against the heat when the weather is hot, against the cold, like in Sweden in summertime. We are the only animal that we don't have fur, we don't have hair, and therefore our body is not immune naturally against the heat or against the cold. Have you noticed that cats, dogs out there, summer or winter, whether in Sweden or in the Middle East or in Africa, they have the same hair, they have the same fur, certain types of animals. Have you ever wondered that how come they don't get cold? How come that we, supposedly more advanced creation of God, we get cold? We need to artificially warm up ourselves because the body temperature that God has given them, the hair or the fur that God has given them, the fact that they walk also on 4 feet, unlike us that we walk on 2 feet, is covering their body more than us. So naturally, their body is more protected naturally. They don't need artificial clothing. Whereas for you and I, as humans, we need to protect ourselves. We are hairless. Sometimes they refer to humans as hairless apes. All right? So because we are hairless by and large, so we need to cover ourselves with clothing. So this idea has emerged and has got more supporters, that the wisdom of clothing is protection against heat, against cold, and against dangerous animals and dangerous creatures. Okay? And that's why if you want to access honey and go to the honeybees and hives, then you have to wear certain clothing. You want to play a sport, certain sport activities require also their own dress code. None of us can go, no matter, even an Ayatollah wants to go swimming, he can go with his amama and abaya to the pool. They won't let him in, no matter who he is. He has to have his own swimming costume. So playing, you don't play rugby here, I suppose. Rugby is a very Aussie and English game. Playing rugby, you have to have your shin pads, all right? For protection. So you want to ride your bike, you need to have a helmet, protection. As you can see that it's very natural, you don't need to be a Muslim to understand this. As I said, the first approach is a very psychological approach. Because it seems more likely that the wisdom of clothing is protection, we extend the idea of protection and say that for the same reason, the protection is not against wild creatures, it's not against cold or heat, it's not against dangerous type of activities, also is against some dangerous humans. As I quote, the ayah Quran refers to them, some who in their hearts there is a disease, they are sick. and to make sure that the rate of rape is not increasing in our society, to make sure that men and women opposite sex, they can interact professionally in a healthy way. The only way to maintain that is that they are not attracted physically to one another, because at the end of the day, we are humans with the human desires and needs. So if they are dressed, if females are dressed modestly, they can maintain their modesty and decency better. And this is for their own protection. So the supporters of hijab are expected to be females, not males, in fact. If males are against the hijab, understandable, because those are lustful men that are promoting sufur or non-hijab or nakedness for them, because they want to satisfy their lusts. Females, and especially feminists, are supposed to be among the very first who support the idea of hijab. So psychologically, we can see that it only makes sense for females to be modestly dressed. Psychology does not give us the details of it, whether their hair needs to be covered or not, what kind of, how much their body has to be covered. Yet still, psychologists, they say that there are some parts of the body, especially females' body, that they refer to as body hot spots. Body hot spots are certain parts of the body that are more appealing to the opposite sex. For a wisdom, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this for a wisdom of multiplication, for the purpose of marriage to take place, so that the two parties are attracted to one another. Her hair is to start with. Her breast, her chest, all right, her legs, her shins, these are what they refer to as the body hot spots. So if she wants to maintain her modesty and chastity, she has to cover these rather attractive parts of her body. To prove it to you that like her hair is definitely one of the body hot spots, think about it. And girls, they can they know more than me, definitely. It's not in my area. The amount of the money that the companies spend for producing various kinds of makeup, the amount of the money that they produce in making various types of shampoo, hair conditioners, hair dyings, and you name it. So much a female can spend, really a mega box she can spend on beautifying her hair, and still every time new things, new stuff are coming up that they can catch up, all right? The notion behind it is what psychologists have noticed, that her hair makes a big difference in her beauty. And that's why, if God forbid, a female has to go through chemotherapy, that as a result of that she's losing her hair, the first reaction that she's going to have to that is depression. Many of them, they go through the stage of depression. She will be depressed, but that she's losing her hair, because her hair is a lot of, it's a big capital for her beauty. All right? So, again, you can see, when we consider the psychology of clothing, a decent dress makes sense to have it. We come, and I'm just trying to make it very short. I've run a course on this topic, and inshallah tonight I'll introduce the package that I have for you. I'm just trying to jump from a session to another one. If someone wants to be a committed Jewess, a committed Christian, a female who wants to say that, look, I want to be a committed Christian, not a Christian who gives only lip service to Christianity. Not even so. I have many priest friends that, like one of them, he was telling me that I've got about 40 nephews and nieces. None of them go to the church. None of them believe in Christianity. Just born in a Christian family. That's all about it. And that's, I tell you, the reason that the way that they deal with this issue is the following. Especially in the Western countries, that is more challenging for them to get the youth coming to the churches. It is clearly stated in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, chapter 25, in the situation of the premarital relation between Rebecca and Isaac, Ishaq, all right? Rebecca and Isaac, apparently they were cousins, first cousins. What is still, according to the Jewish law, they were not mahram to each other. it says that Rebecca with her maid, she is making a trip or they're going from somewhere to another, and she was not properly dressed because there's no non-mahram at all. And the moment that she notices a guy is coming, a young man is approaching, asking the maid, who is he? And she goes, that is Isaac, your cousin. She covered her head with her veil in front of a non-mahram. A widow in the Jewish tradition was more expected to cover herself. A widow's weeds, weeds, a cover that is like abaya, from head to toes. She had to cover herself in black, like that. In the Orthodox Jewish tradition, females were expected to even cover their faces even. Alright? About covering the face, at least according to the Shia fiqh, our fuqaha, almost all of them are unanimous that this is not obligated. You know that face and hands are exempt for her comfort. Orthodox Jewish tradition says that she has to even cover her hair, her face. Alright? So if somebody wants to practice Judaism, a female who wants to practice Judaism has to be dressed and cover her hair and her body as well. Today's Jews, they are not practicing. They are seculars, really. They don't practice their book. We come to New Testament. In the New Testament also, one of the letters that Saint Paul is writing to the saints of Corinthian saints, in his first letter, you can read it in the New Testament, chapter 11. Please make sure you read it. And this is a passage, I shared it with the priest, and he was dumbfounded. I'll come to that after I mentioned the story. Saint Paul's, that you know, Christians, they regard him as, astaghfirullah, I'm excuse the example, I'm giving like the Imam Ali of for the Shia, like Abu, like Omar for the Sunnis. That's how much they respect him, alright? In his first letter to the Corinthians, he writes that it is the practice of Jesus Christ that it is not becoming of women to come to the churches without their head covered, without their hair covered. If they wish to come without their hair covered, they have to shave their heads. But because it is disgraceful for a woman to have her hair shaved, let her hair be covered. Alright? So in the old days that Christianity was more practiced, females, women could not go to the church on Sundays unless they cover their heads. Still in the Middle East, if you look at the, if you've been to the churches in the Middle East, that there are more traditional Christians, when they go to the church, young and old, they put something on their head. Traditional. They don't properly, but they put something, a scarf or something on their head. I confronted one of the priests in Australia, and I said to him that on Sunday he had invited me to give a talk about, and I had chosen to talk about Mary, all right, Maryam Salamullah alayha, from the perspective of Quran Muslim. After the meeting, after the lecture, everything was over, when we were sitting in his office, I said to him that, Father, when I was coming to the church, and I went with my wife, and we were telling each other, are we going to a wedding reception, or we are going to a place of worship? The way that women were dressed, come on, is this a place of worship or is it a wedding reception? And you know what he said? He goes that, you know, Mansoor, I quoted this to him. First he denied it. He thought that he's talking to, like, I don't know what I'm talking about. I said, come on, man. Let's grab the Bible and read it. As soon as I said that to read it to him, then he said, okay, you know what, you're right. But if I want to mention these such quotations to my audience, to my community, they won't turn up to the church. They won't come anymore. So we have to give it a miss. Here, I want to make a quick footnotes. Be very careful, although we have to talk with the young girls and others with wisdom, but please never sacrifice your values just because you want them to come to the masjid, otherwise they won't come to the masjid. What's the point of coming to the masjid if they were not practicing Islam? And if we don't want to practice Islam, let's meet midway. At least when you come to the masjid, respect the law. I've invited a minister in Australia with his wife to the masjid, to our center, and we introduced the code of practice, the code of hijab, and his wife had to be properly dressed to come to the masjid. impossibly anyone can go to a synagogue of the Jews and you don't wear that little hat on your head. Oh, what's the significance of that? You have to respect it. This is their synagogue. That's the law. Likewise, sister, you are at least a born Muslim. You come to a place of worship, to the masjid. You cannot really play with the emotions of these guys who've come to worship God. You disturb them. This is violation of others' rights, okay? Anyway, he told me, he said that if I want to mention these quotations, these passages of the Bible to our audience, they won't turn up to the church. So, as a committed Christian, they are expected to practice hijab. They don't practice it because they don't believe in Christianity. Not that doesn't exist in Christianity. Let me tell you something here, that point, inshallah, will help you solve a puzzle with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
I don't know whether you have experienced it or not. I have myself many times. I was in the lift in the shopping center with my wife, with my daughter. We are going down, and an Aussie guy, he is looking at my daughter and goes that, did your dad ask you to wear this? Because the assumption is that this is an authority of the father or the authority of the husband over the woman to dress like this. You know why they are making these comments? You need to understand where they are coming from. The reason that they make such comments is because in their distorted, perverted Bible, it says, and I quote, that head cover is a sign of authority of a man over his woman, wife or daughter. Head cover of a female is the sign of the authority of a man over his woman, wife or daughter. And Jesus is the authority over men. There's a hierarchy, in other words. The hierarchy works like this, that females are in the lowest level of that hierarchy. Her husband has authority over her. The sign of that authority is her hair has to be covered. This is as a gesture of authority of her husband or her father. Above men is Jesus. So Jesus has authority over men. And above Jesus is God. God has authority over Jesus. So that's how the hierarchy works. So if you see the tenor and tell you that the reason that you have your hair covered, is it because your husband or your dad had asked you? Because in their distorted culture, this is the sign of authority. And women, with women liberation, they wanted to liberate themselves from such authorities. Why my husband has to have authority over me? I don't want it. Take it off. And it was taken off with this assumption. In the same way that in the West, so many, they turn around and tell you that they are atheists. They don't believe in God. After a bit of discussion with them, you see that you are also atheist. I'm an atheist as well, in that sense. Because by atheist, they mean that I don't believe Jesus Christ is God. I tell them, well, I don't believe either, man. If that makes you an atheist, I'm an atheist before you. If the purpose of clothing and wearing the hair is because of the authority of your husband or your dad, we don't have that. That's not the wisdom for that. That's not the reason. The reason is what the psychological reason that I mentioned to you. Let's move on to Islam with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Is there any ayah in the Quran about the hijab and the head cover? A lady, she asked me, in Australia, almost all my experiences are there, I've lived there for such a long time. I said to her, there is. She said, no, there isn't. And she's, mind you, a Muslim. She born Shia. Over the phone, we're talking, and I said to her that, well, just give it a chance that maybe there is. She said, no, I know Quran, there isn't. You sheikhs, you mashayikh have made this one up. And there's no such thing. I said, sister, I'm not going to bet, but if there is, are you submitting yourself to the Quran? She said, there isn't. I said, Allahu Akbar. Hypothetically speaking, just for the sake of argument, let us assume there is. If there isn't, I promise you that I'm not going to oblige it on. Why should I oblige it on my wife and my daughter? If there is, then are you willing to practice it? She said, yes. I said, all right, listen to me. And I quoted one of the ayah. One ayah in Surah Nur that I want to share with you is what I said to her. One of them is the following. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وليضربنا بخمورهن على جيوبهن. Only that part of it is not for us to prove. I said to her that, look, Quran says that they must ضرب, when, like, I'm putting this part of my aba on this part, I'm like hitting this on this, like this, overlapping it. This is called ضرب العباية على العباية, that my abaya is just overlapping the other side of it. وَلْيَضْرِبْنَا بِخُمُرِهِنَّ females, they should bring their خمار. خمر is the plural form of خمار. خمار literally means headscarf. Why do I say headscarf? Because خمر, you all know, have heard of this term خمر in Arabic, wine. Why intoxicants in Islam is called خمر? Because it's covering the head. It's concealing the brain and the head. The person, once he's drunk, his brain is not functioning anymore. He's not conscious, you know, of things that he says and does. خمار, therefore, is something that is covering the head. Even this imame and the type of dishtashe that in Arabic culture, because of the wind of the desert, and in the Arabic tradition, it wasn't, mind you, only women who were wearing their head. Many men, they were covering their head as well, because they wanted to protect themselves against the sand of the desert, all right? But Quran says that how you cover your heads, like with the scarf that you are covering your heads, make sure that you take your scarf long enough that your chest, your neck is also covered. وَلِيَضْرِبْنَا بُخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. This is jayb. Jayb is this, like the color of your shirt is your jayb. That your neck and your chest is covered. Why Quran says that? History confirms that before the revelation of the ayah, in fact, before the advent of Islam, Arab women and non-Arab women even, in the old days, it was a very common culture, whether they come from Christian, Jewish, all those Zoroastrian background or Jahiliyyah, they were all covering their heads naturally and normally by instinct, by nature. They were not like today's nakedness of the 21st century, all right? But their scarves were loose. All what Quran had to say is that you are covering, it's just like a woman who is not properly dressed. Said, Haji, have a sister, you, mashallah, you are covering yourself. Why don't you do it a bit better? You do it properly. Cover your neck and your chest as well as referring to body hot spots, because your neck, your chest is attracting attention. You don't want to put yourself in a dangerous situation. You don't want to be assaulted sexually. So cover it. And there's a background to that. That a young guy was walking off the street. Another girl on the other side is walking, and she was not dressed properly. Her chest could be seen. The young lustful boy, as he's walking, he kept staring at her as he's walking. He did not realize as he was walking, now you're going to laugh. As he was walking, staring at her, enjoying her eyes, his eyes, all of a sudden he hit the edge of a wall with his forehead. And mind you that there was also a piece of like glass or something pierced the forehead, and the guy was bleeding. With his face full of blood, he went to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulallah, look at this mess that this woman, they caused us. What is this, Ya Rasulallah? The Prophet said, Ajeeb. She did that to you, or you did that to yourself? The ayah was revealed. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْكَى لَهُمْ. Say to the believing men, lower your gaze. Yes, true that she was not dressed properly, but you also were looking lustful. You are not supposed to stare at her. First, you lower your gaze. And then Quran goes to them after وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ, and then the ayah comes, وَلِيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. Let's meet midways. We guys are expected to lower our gaze, not to have a lustful look. And you girls also, it's not enough. It's foolish to say that it's my body, I like to dress as I like it. No, it is your body. It is everybody's body. But you don't, if you don't do your job, if you don't protect yourself, don't expect others to protect you. If you don't dress modestly and go to the public and something happens to you, then you are to be blamed as well. Yes, the perpetrator of that sin has to be punished as well, but it's not like this only. You don't leave your car unattended and not lock it. Say that, I don't want to lock it. Why can't the government control it that there are no thieves in this country? You don't just leave your house unlocked. You lock your house, you lock your car, and then you're expecting others like to behave themselves as well. That's how we live, you know, normal. That's a common sense. So definitely there is hijab in the Quran as one of the examples. Hijab of the females is not limited to covering their head and bodies. Some, they think that the head is only a taboo. I've seen some cultures that so well she's covering her hair, but the hairstyle is like a horn is coming up, you know, like that from behind her scarf. This is not a proper hijab. Or she's wearing such a tight skin color, you call it pants, trousers, or shirt like that. That's again not her hijab. That's not a proper hijab. Yes, her skin is not seen, but that's not enough. Quran says even you should observe hijab in the way that you speak with an opposite sex. Remember that in our madhab, speaking between male and female is not haram. But it depends. If she's professional in the way that she speaks, fine. But فَلَا تَخْضَعْنَ بِالْقُولِ فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٌ. Sisters, girls, don't speak in a seducing way, in a loosey way, like some companies that they want to employ a girl and they say to her that, like, you should be able to sell yourself to be able to sell my products. And the way that she answers the calls, the way she speaks to the clients, you know, the way that she speaks really is like to seduce. Based on that psychological theory we're talking about, that's not what a Muslim girl is expected. Likewise, guys, unfortunately, sometimes in a corporate, you know, work, they are used to, he goes to a girl, "Hi, love, how are you?" And then they are so much used to this terminology, he comes to the masjid and speaks with the girl, "Hi, love, how are you?" Ajeeb. Astaghfirullah. Brother, even over there, you are not allowed to use this terminology, let alone talking to your Muslim sister. Behave yourself. Both sides, they're expected to. So the way that we converse one another, it matters. It's part of the decency, part of the modesty. Quran says the way you walk also matters. Remember that anything that is provocative must be avoided. وَلَا يَضْرِبْنَا بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ. The way, like in the old days, and still some Arabic cultures, they have this, what we call it, khalkhal. It's the bracelet that they wear on the arm. If it's worn by the feet, they call it khalkhal. Quran says that don't walk the way that if you're wearing khalkhal, that it's hitting each other, making noise. In the old days, men used to have nails under their feet, the sole of their shoes, so that when he was walking, a female could tell that a guy is coming, like she properly dresses and you know. Today, many times we guys, we have to be careful because we see that a long heeler is coming. Bang, 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 the way that she is walking. And all right, Quran so is talking about that, wearing long heel shoes as well. Don't wear this type of shoes that you are attracting attention the way that you are walking. So please remember, it's not only the hair that has to be covered, it's a full package. That's why our fuqaha, they say that the clothing also has to be loose. Why? Because the body shape, remember the body, how the spots that we're talking about, the body shape also matters. It's not only that my skin is not seen, so it should be enough. No, my friend. Even if your skin is not seen, that's why going to the mixed gym, especially wearing tight clothing, is not appropriate. Going on a treadmill, running, and with the guys around you, this is not becoming, this is not a practice of hijab. To say that, yeah, I have my loose pant. No, sister, you're jumping up and down in front of guys. This is not, there again, you're not practicing hijab. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah, after I read the majlis, I have a small presentation to continue these sessions, inshallah. you. But tonight, being the last night, remember last night I read mentioned something about Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Farajuhu Sharif. Being the host of our majalis, and Fatima al-Zahra Salamullah Alayha is also the host, not only for females, but especially for the sisters, especially talking about the modesty and hijab, who was the crystallization of chastity and modesty. From the time of the burial of Fatima al-Zahra, even though her burial was so privately done at night time, following her own will, still she was the very first who wrote in her will and mentioned it verbally to her husband, Ya Ali, when you want to carry my body to my grave, put my body in a coffin, tabut, put my body in a coffin that has sides, because until her time, males or females, men and women who would die, they would carry them on the piece of timber. So the body shape could be seen, even for females. It was only from the time of Fatima al-Zahra that she's asking Imam Ali alayhi salam that when you carry my body, don't carry my dead body. I don't have the heart yet to say my dead body. Her dead body, don't carry me on a piece of timber that the strangers, non-mahram, they can see my body shape. Make sure you make coffin for me, like the taboo that we have these days. SubhanAllah, Fatima al-Zahra doesn't want, even when she's no longer alive, for the strangers to see her body shape. How can one say that I love Fatima al-Zahra and I'm young and alive, and I don't care whether my body shape would be seen or not, or I'm displaying it, astaghfirullah. Fatima al-Zahra was a type of a woman that a blind man comes to her house, you know the story, and Fatima steps away, goes to another room, and the Prophet says, Ya Binti, my dear daughter, she's blind. He is blind. And Fatima says that, yes, he is blind, but he can smell me. This is the role model that we have, really. For those who want to receive the intercession of Fatima al-Zahra, there has to be some sort of compatibility, inshallah, about it. Fatima al-Zahra, salamullah alayha, lived a very short life in this dunya. Remember one night, I think I mentioned that among the Bakka'un, those who cried most in this dunya, remember I said one of them was Fatima al-Zahra, salamullah alayha. From the time that her father, the Prophet of Islam, passed away, until when she was martyred and left this dunya, maximum 3 months, but yet day and night she was in tears and crying because of what had happened to her husband, crying because of what had happened to herself. The right of her husband was taken away, she was violated, and the privacy of her house was even violated, you know, they attacked her house. So much so that even when Imam Ali alayhi salam, in the darkness of night, he is bathing and doing the ritual bathing of Fatima al-Zahra. Asma says that Imam Ali had asked us that nobody should cry loud so that the enemies can hear us. The funeral was taking place privately, quietly in their house. But she says that all of a sudden I noticed that Abu al-Hassan, Amir al-Mu'mineen, he left the bathing of his wife, Fatima al-Zahra, and he's putting his head against the wall and he's crying loud. I turned and said, Ya Abu al-Hassan, Ya Sayyidi wa Mawlai, you advised us not to cry. What happened that you just left the taghsil? And Imam Ali alayhi salam says, Ya Asma, as I was washing the daughter of the Prophet, I noticed the bruise on her arm. I noticed the broken rib of Fatima al-Zahra. She had not shown it to me. I don't know how painful the situation was that Imam Ali, who was the crystallization of patience, when he is putting his wife into the grave, he himself goes to the grave with Fatima
placing her in the grave. And then Imam Ali bursts into tears. I don't know when he is just uncovering the face of the daughter of the Prophet. And he turned around looking towards the grave of the Prophet. Ya Rasulallah, Al-la'an safiyyatika sabriyi. ورق عنها تجلدي يا رسول الله. Your cousin Ali, your successor Ali, your brother Ali is losing his patience. It is so difficult for Ali to see the bruises on the arm of his wife, yet he has to endure patience. على لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أيام غلب ينقلبون. صلوات
الله على
محمد وعلى آله. While you are getting ready for your questions, if I can just set my laptop.
Is it on?
Yeah.
Yeah, bon. Ingo.
This program that I'm introducing to you, the reason for that is the following. First of all, as I suggested to the brothers last night, really we don't want it to be just Muharram to Muharram coming to Imam Ali's mosque. Make an arrangement with the youth, and alhamdulillah you have brothers like Haj Haydar around, that you come at least on a weekly basis to attend, you know, and maintain your spirituality, to learn about your religion. Here in the West, brothers and sisters, the government don't expect the Swedish government to arrange a sheikh for you, to arrange Islamic classes for you. The fact that they give some sort of grants to the mosque is really more than enough. You don't get this in many countries even. So you need to arrange that for yourselves. And alhamdulillah, with the aid of the internet, with the aid of the technology, there is no more an issue that I'm living somewhere else in the world. Distance is not an issue. Last night, to give you an example, at 2 o'clock, I was running a class as of my normal classes that I'm running weekly for Dearborn, Michigan. And I've got classes, maybe you notice it on my, I will show you later on my desktop, that I've got different clocks of different parts of the world because of the classes that I'm running online. And it works well live. I see them, they see me, lectures, and then Q&A, and everything works well. So many universities, you know, that today they are coming online, they are running it in a virtual, virtual universities are coming up. Some years ago, I was browsing on the net, and accidentally I came across the University of Haifa in Israel, occupied Palestine. And I noticed that the lecturer was running a course about Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallahu farajahu al-sharif. I logged in and I went as a visitor as well. And guess how many people were logged in, how many visitors, how many students were online watching that guy. From my memory, I have still the screenshot of that class, over 30,000. Over 30,000 students online were watching him. And guess who this guy was? I did a bit of homework about him. He was an Iranian Baha'i, left Iran, residing in Israel, and now he's running a course on Imam Mahdi in Haifa University, or PhD level. All right? The one who does, these people, they have absolutely no idea and no faith in Imam Mahdi, of course. Baha'is, if you know who they are. I'm telling, and this is so many years ago. It was then that I decided, alhamdulillah, the Almighty God inspired us. We came up with this project of that we called it E-Hawze. E stands for English and Electronic. Back then we started this. There is so much I can talk about the significance and the importance of having like programs in a language of the land that we understand, educating our youth. Because if we don't do something about ourselves, believe me, there are people like that university that I told you that they are increasing more and more. And the governments are granting them more and more that they want to distort the religion of Islam, distort the madhhab of tashayyu within us, in our own communities. If there is not proper alternative for them, they go there. They go to the universities. After September 11, so many Western universities, secular universities, are given grants, millions of dollars of grants are given to open a school of Islamic studies, Middle East studies. These schools of Islamic studies are not to teach you and I proper Islam, are to teach us distorted Islam. We have to be very careful and alert, alert, alert. It took us about 8 years to develop this diploma. What we mean by diploma? Diploma is once you have finished year 10 or year 12 of the high school studying, this takes you 2 more years to study about Islam. This diploma gives you a general knowledge about all Islamic subjects that you need. All the Islamic subjects. And it definitely, those who do this diploma, they have a good, clear understanding of so many different Islamic topics. I don't have time to take you through, but you can later on go to our website www.ehawze.com, and the list of all the courses, semesters and lectures are there, and you can see what you will be learning. And the beauty of this, the intention behind this was we wanted to make it for the English speaking people. The notion behind this was that as we have Hawze Ilmiya in Najaf in Arabic, we have Hawze Ilmiya in Iran in Farsi, we have Hawze Ilmiya in Karachi, for example, in Urdu. It is also possible to run Islamic Hawze Cemetery in English, the language that people understand best. There is no prerequisite for this diploma. You don't need to have any knowledge or Arabic or anything at all. You can start from scratch. The first semester is divided into 4 semesters, and each semester has own courses, and each course has own subjects and lessons. You see, Islam in a nutshell, Islam in a nutshell, it means that I'm just a new Muslim. I just embrace Islam today. I want to know what this Islam is all about. I start from here. I don't need to know anything about Islam. And how would I know? I just press on this. Every lecture, I'm just randomly pressing them. We go down. Every lecture has a PowerPoint or an abstract plus the audio. If necessary to have video, there's a video. Like, for example, later on,